Hey everybody, welcome back. In this video, we're discussing radiographic grids. Radiographic grids have a very specific design and purpose. A grid uses a plate of thin lead strips to prevent scatter from striking the image receptor, and that improves image quality by increasing image contrast. Grids are not always necessary, but an X-ray operator must understand how they function and how to use them correctly. Failure to use grids correctly can result in non-diagnostic images and excessive patient dose. Several types of X-ray imaging equipment use grids, including stationary X-ray rooms, fluoroscopy equipment, computed tomography, and mammography. Grids are sometimes necessary because of scatter radiation. When the X-ray beam is passing through the patient, some photons are completely absorbed through the photoelectric effect, some are transmitted through the patient without interacting at all, and some will be scattered through interactions called coherent scattering and Compton scattering. Absorbed photons and transmitted photons are good for image quality because these processes create the radiographic shadow of the patient's anatomy. Scatter radiation is not good because these photons are no longer in line with the rest of the X-ray beam. As a result, scatter radiation creates a layer of noise in the image that disrupts the visibility of the patient's anatomy and any pathologies. Compare this process to how you can use a flashlight to make a shadow of your hand. Some of the light is absorbed by your hand, and some of the light transmits past your hand. The combination of absorption and transmission is what creates that nice high contrast shadow of your hand. Now imagine what would happen if we added other light sources that are out of alignment with the flashlight. These other light photons add light to the image, but this added light actually degrades the visibility of your hand. Scatter radiation is like this. Scatter radiation adds useless information to the image and degrades the image quality. Digital radiography processing is quite effective at maintaining optimal image contrast even when scatter radiation is high. Still, radiographic image quality can be improved by decreasing the proportion of scatter radiation striking the image receptor. There are several ways to do this, such as using collimation to create a small exposure field and using other beam-limiting devices. But even when these methods are used, there is still scatter created in the patient that can be removed by using a radiographic grid. So how do grids work? A grid is placed between the patient and the image receptor to absorb scatter before it strikes the image receptor. Grids do not decrease the production of scatter within the patient, but they do remove scatter from the beam before it strikes the image receptor and degrades the image quality. Grids are constructed from very thin, vertical lead strips that are spaced apart by a radiolucent material, such as aluminum or plastic. Due to this vertical orientation of the lead strips, transmitted photons from the main beam that carry good information are allowed to pass right through the grid to the image receptor, and that's what we want. However, scatter photons that are out of line with the main beam and carry only meaningless noise strike the vertical strips and are absorbed. Useful photons are allowed to pass through, but scatter photons are obstructed by the grid. The efficiency of a grid in removing scatter is designated by its grid ratio. The grid ratio is defined as the height of the lead strip compared to the distance between them. For example, a grid having lead strips 2 millimeters high and having 1 millimeter of distance between each strip has a grid ratio of 2 divided by 1, which is 2 to 1. If the distance between the strips decreases to 0.5 millimeters, then the new grid ratio is 2 divided by 0.5, which is the same as 4 to 1. There is a direct relationship between grid ratio and grid efficiency. As grid ratio increases, scatter reduction increases, and contrast improvement increases. Common grid ratios include 5 to 1, 6 to 1, 8 to 1, 10 to 1, 12 to 1, and 16 to 1. The choice of a grid ratio depends on several factors, including the body part being imaged, the size of the patient, the KVP used, and giving consideration to the patient dose. For example, imaging of small extremities, such as hands or feet, on small patients usually does not require a grid at all. The KVP is low, and the proportion of scatter radiation striking the image receptor is so minimal that the use of a grid does not have a meaningful effect on image quality. Grids are generally not necessary on body parts less than 10 centimeters thick. Conversely, imaging of large body parts, those 10 centimeters or greater, like the skull, abdomen, or pelvis, on large patients can be significantly improved by using a high ratio grid, like 12:1 or 16:1. The KVP is high, and the proportion of scatter radiation striking the image receptor is so high that a grid does provide a meaningful increase in image quality. Patient dose is also a consideration because using a grid does require a significant increase in the exposure technique. Here's why. Grids absorb mostly scatter radiation, but a percentage of the useful beam is also absorbed. As a result, using a grid significantly reduces the receptor exposure. When using a grid, then, the mass must be increased to maintain the appropriate receptor exposure. Without adjusting the mass, the noise from scatter radiation will just be replaced by quantum noise, called model, from inadequate receptor exposure. So how much should the mass be increased? I'm sure you'll be excited to know there is some math involved. This is called the grid conversion formula. The base formula looks like this. Mass 2 over mass 1 is equal to grid conversion factor 2 over grid conversion factor 1. Mass 2 is just the new mass. That's the number that we have to calculate. Mass 1 is the original mass. That's the mass we would use based on the original grid ratio. Grid conversion factor 2 is the grid conversion factor for the new grid, and grid conversion factor 1 is the grid conversion factor for the original grid. A very useful form of this formula looks like this. Mass 2 equals mass 1 multiplied by grid conversion factor 2 divided by grid conversion factor 1. It's actually the same formula, but in this form, we can solve directly for the new mass without any extra steps or cross multiplication. Here's the average grid conversion factors that we must know to use this formula. No grid is equal to 1. 5:1 is equal to 2. A 6:1 grid is 3. 8:1 equals 4. 10:1 is 5. 12:1 is also 5. And a 16:1 grid has a grid conversion factor of 6. We'll use a practice problem to explain how this formula works. A radiograph of the chest was performed in a cart without a grid using 100 kVp and 2 mass. The resulting image demonstrated adequate receptor exposure, but excessive scatter radiation. How should the exposure technique be modified if the examination is repeated with a 10:1 radiographic grid? The mass should be modified using the grid conversion formula. We can't just guess. This is necessary to ensure the scatter is decreased while maintaining the same receptor exposure. The KVP should not be changed. So we'll start with the formula and insert all known variables. The formula is mass 2 is equal to mass 1 times grid conversion factor 2 over grid conversion factor 1. The original mass was 2. The new grid conversion factor for a 10:1 grid is 5. The original grid conversion factor for no grid is 1. To calculate mass 2, that's the new mass, we simply follow the math in the formula. The new mass, that's mass 2, is equal to 2 times 5 divided by 1, which equals 10 mass. That's all there is to it. There's no additional steps. Here's another example. A portable radiograph of the pelvis is to be acquired. If the technique chart indicates 12 mass should be used with an 8:1 grid, how should the technique be changed if the procedure is performed with a 16:1 grid? It might be tempting to just double the mass since the grid ratio doubled, but that's actually not how it works. Start with the formula and we'll insert all known variables. Mass 2 equals mass 1 times grid conversion factor 2 divided by grid conversion factor 1. The prescribed mass, according to the technique chart, is 12. The new grid conversion factor for a 16-to-1 grid is 6. The original grid conversion factor for an 8-to-1 grid is 4. So to calculate the new mass, we just follow the math that's in this formula. The new mass, that's mass 2, is equal to 12 times 6 divided by 4, which equals 18 mass. To summarize the key points, grids prevent scatter from striking the image receptor. Grids can improve image quality by increasing image contrast. Digital processing does most of the work, but sometimes grids help. Grids are constructed from very thin vertical lead strips spaced apart by a radiolucent material. The efficiency of a grid is determined by the grid ratio, which is equal to the lead strip height divided by the space between the strips. Finally, when changing grid ratio, the mass must also be changed to maintain the correct receptor exposure. If you enjoyed this video, I encourage you to visit cloverlearning.com and explore our robust selection of video-based courses, certification exam prep question banks, and continuing education resources. Lastly, please remember to hit the like button, subscribe, and turn on notifications so you can stay up to date on our latest videos.